So let's say that we're going to play repeated trading games. And if you're very agreeable, then you're going to bargain harder on my behalf than you're going to bargain on your own behalf. Whereas if you're very disagreeable, you're going to do the reverse. You're going to think, I'm in this trading game for me, and you're going to take care of your own interests, where an agreeable person is going to say, no, no, at best, this is at worst, this has to be 50-50, but I'd like to help you every way I can. Okay, now the so you kind of understand that. Now the advantage to being agreeable then is that you're good in teams and you're very much likely to give other people credit. The downside of being agreeable is that you're not very good at putting forward your own interests. And so one of the things that predicts salary across time, for example, is agreeableness, and it predicts it negatively. And so it's part of the reason why women get paid less than men. And this is something for the women in the class to really listen to. Because how you get paid across time depends on a very large number of things, right? It depends on your skills and your abilities and your position and your social network and all of that. But the other thing it depends on is whether or not you actually go ask for money. Or maybe that you don't even ask. Because actually, you don't ask for money. You tell people that you need to be paid more or something they don't like will happen. And I don't mean as a threat. I mean that you have to be willing, when you're negotiating, to have an alternative. You go talk to your boss, who isn't going to give you money, because everyone wants money, right? It's a competitive game. You're going to have to go there and say, look, here's what I do. Here's why it's useful. Here's why you have to give me more money. And this is my opportunities if you don't. And then you're not taking your boss's money anyways, because it's very seldom, very frequently the case that he's working for a whopping big company. But he needs an excuse to give you money, because everyone's asking for money all the time. And so you have to put your case forward powerfully and disagreeably. Now, you don't want to do it too disagreeably, because then he's going to think that you're a son of a... and maybe he's not going to give you anything, and maybe you'll get fired for being mouthy and all of that. And that certainly happens to people who are too disagreeable. You got to get the balance right. But it's definitely the case. And the other thing that happens to women that's also worth noting, and this is probably because they're higher in negative emotion, is they tend to underestimate their own utility in business settings. Right? Because if you're trying to evaluate what you're like, and you're more tilted towards negative emotion, then the things that you do that are wrong are going to stand out more on the foreground than the things that you do that are right. So if you go into a negotiation and you're uncertain already because you have self-doubts, and then you're agreeable in the negotiation, what's going to happen is that you're not going to win as often. And winning in a business setting or in a career development setting means more opportunity for promotion and more revenue generated. Now, the downside of that, of course, is as you climb the business hierarchy is that you also have to take on more responsibility. And that responsibility is sometimes unpleasant as well, especially to people who are agreeable, because you're not necessarily liked if you're in a position of authority. And agreeable people really like to be liked. It's their primary motivator, because they're concerned about the maintenance, I would say, of intimate, positive relationships. I mean, that also makes them conflict avoidant. Okay, so now, you guys can think about this, but I'll tell you why I think the personality differences between men and women exist. Now, these are speculative hypotheses, but they're reasonably well documented by the relevant literature. So let's think about it. The first thing we might think about is, what's the difference between men and women? Well, how do they differ? Well, the first thing we might observe is that if you look at personality differences between prepubescent boys and girls, they're not very large. Boys and girls don't differ in terms of their trait neuroticism, for example. What happens is that when puberty kicks in, women's trait neuroticism rises, and it stays higher than men for the rest of their life. And this is why you see this reflected in the different kinds of psychopathology that beset the two sexes. So men are overrepresented in alcoholism, drug abuse, antisocial personality, and a host of learning disorders, as well as attention deficit disorder. And women are overrepresented in depression and anxiety, primarily. That seems to be tightly associated with higher levels of trait neuroticism. Because maybe it's, if you're at the 95th percentile or higher, let's say, in trait neuroticism, there isn't much difference between that and being somewhat prone to depression and anxiety. And because the curves overlap, you know, the curves aren't identical, the normal distributions aren't identical for men and women, you tilt the one to the right, to the women's curve to the right towards higher levels of neuroticism, you go out and you look for the person in 20 who has the highest levels of negative emotion. It's much more likely to be female than male. Okay, so let's see if we can figure out why. So I'm going to tell you some things, basic differences between men and women, and you can tell me what you think about it if you agree or disagree. Okay, first, size differential emerges between men and women at puberty, right? Because boys and girls are roughly the same size and roughly the same strength, but men get bigger at puberty when the testosterone kicks in, and more importantly, not only do they get taller and heavier, but their upper body strength is much higher. And that's a real issue for combat, because human beings punch. There's other animals that do that. Kangaroos do that too, eh? So we're not the only people that punch, but we have clubs on the ends of our arms. So that's interesting. So okay, so there's a body size difference that's important, a strength differential that's important. Next thing, I think. So let's assume that the reason that women are higher in sensitivity to negative emotion is because the world is actually more dangerous to women. I think that women's nervous systems are not adapted to women. I think women's nervous systems are adapted to the mother-infant dyad. And because you are not the same creature when you have an infant, not at all. You're way more vulnerable. And it's partly because you have to express the vulnerability of the infant and you also have to care for it, right? So you think about an infant, especially under 9 months. So let's say, how are you going to be wired up if you're going to optimally care for an infant under 9 months? And I'm saying under 9 months because women generally do the bulk of childcare for infants who are under 9 months old. And part of the reason for that, there's a whole host of reasons, but part of the reasons for that, obviously, is that they breastfeed. But imagine what you need to be wired up biologically in order to care for an infant. First of all, they're very demanding, right? Because they're completely helpless. And they're demanding 24 hours a day, and it's quite a emotional load. And an infant under 9 months is never wrong, right? What you do to an infant under 9 months is when they're in distress, you always respond. You never tell the infant, get your act together and stop whining, right? Which you can do, say, to a child that's 18 months old. You can start having that sort of conversation. But under 9 months, it's like nothing is the infant's fault. It's surrounded in an extraordinarily threatening world, and you have to be responsive to what it needs, regardless of what you want, and you have to be very sensitive to the threats that emerge in the environment. And so I think the price that women pay for that ability to have an intimate relationship with infants in the very earliest stages of development is that their nervous systems are actually wired so that they can perform that role optimally. And the disadvantage to that is that having a temperament like that doesn't work that well when you're dealing with adult men, especially when you're dealing with them in a business environment, because it's not the same thing, not at all. It's a competitive environment. So, okay, so agreeable people are compassionate and polite. What are disagreeable people like? They're tough-minded, they're blunt, they're competitive, and they won't do a damn thing they don't want to do. So it isn't exactly that they're aggressive, although they will push you the hell out of their way if you're in the way. They're not like volatile like you are if you're high in neuroticism. It isn't defensive aggression, it's more like predatory aggression. It's dominance behavior. And so for someone who's highly disagreeable, they look at the world as a place in which they can compete and win. And I'll tell you a story. I have a friend, I gave him my personality test, the big five aspect scale that Colin DeYoung developed in my lab, and I knew he was a disagreeable guy. And by interacting with him. I mean, he's even rude to people sort of spontaneously on the street. I actually like him quite a bit. He's very, very funny. He's also very conscientious, so you can trust him, but he's disagreeable as hell. And so I gave him this test because I thought it would be funny, and he came out as the most disagreeable person in 10,000. So reasonable in compassion, about 30th percentile, but like 0.001 in politeness. So he's extraordinarily blunt, and he'll just say absolutely anything, no matter how horrible it is. And he was often brought into corporations to sort of clean them up. So if a corporation was tilting and not doing well, they'd bring him in to find out who the useless people were and fire them. And I talked to him about that because I've had the missed opportunity to have to not have graduate students in my lab, for example, that weren't performing well, and I find it very, very difficult to, you know, dress someone down, and certainly difficult to fire them. I just hate it because I'm actually quite an agreeable person, much to my chagrin. And I asked him about that, and I said, well, what do? You have to fire people all the time. How do you handle that? He says, handle it? I enjoy it. And I thought, wow, that's so interesting that someone would have that response. I said, well, what do you mean you enjoy it? He said, look, I go into these companies and I analyze the performance of groups of people, right? And there's in those groups, there are people who are really striving, really trying hard and working themselves really hard and being productive. And then there's these people that are just doing nothing. They're completely in the way. They don't carry their weight at all. They take advantage every chance they get. And they're always whining about why they can't work. It's like, I find out who they are, I call them into my office, and I tell them exactly what they've been doing. It's like, hit the road, buddy. You've had your run of it. And I thought, oh yeah, okay, fair enough. You know, well, I can tell you, you know, I've had situations in my lab where I had underperforming graduate students. And one of the things that was really awful about that was that it was really hard on the high-performing graduate students, you know, because they felt that even being in the same category as the people who weren't working hard and pulling their weight devalued what they were doing, you know, and that's exactly right. And so this is also why there's a conscientiousness trait and an agreeableness trait. Because conscientious people judge you on your accomplishments, right? They don't give a damn about your feelings, not a bit. It's like, are you doing the work or not? Whereas agreeable people think, well, you know, your mother's sick and, you know, you've got a bunch of family problems and we all have to take care of each other and it's no wonder that you're having a rough time. And like, you can't say that one of those attitudes is correct and the other isn't correct. You can't say that. There wouldn't be those two dimensions if there wasn't something correct about both of them. But you can certainly point out that often they conflict, you know, and so the demand for inclusiveness and unity and care and the demand for high-level performance in a hierarchical structure, they're very different orientations in the world. And so it's complicated for people who are agreeable and conscientious. And actually, I think often that large corporations and large institutions of any sort run on the unheralded labor of people who are high in agreeableness and high in conscientiousness, and they're disproportionately women. And my experience in large institutions has been that if you want to hire someone to exploit appropriately, no, not appropriately, if you want to hire someone to exploit productively, you hire middle-aged women who are hyper-conscientious and who are agreeable, because they'll do everything. They won't take credit for it and they won't complain.